Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the final game of the night here for the Northern Arena presented by Bell. This is the last of the round two upper bracket, Wild Witch Doctors versus Infamous. This is game three, the ace match decider. WWD taking game one, Infamous looking strong in game two off the back of King Tekka God finding the biggest crushes we've seen this side of the Mississippi. I'm Zayori, joined again by Mott Pax here on Moondock TV. Thank you for joining us. We're all so excited to go to Canada in a couple months' time here for the big land that these teams are fighting so hard for. Oh, man, I can't wait. We're going to have poutine.
What a distant and magical land.
I know, man.
Where the people live in igloos.
Our neighbors are microwaves. You don't have microwaves?
No, we have microwaves.
See, why? I was ready to believe.
Yeah, no.
They have cars in Europe?
I know. It's a beautiful country. It's nice. It's actually cold. I'm wearing slippers. I have started wearing my slippers. It has gotten to that point. No more barefoot in the house, guys. It's almost October.
It's going to happen soon in Colorado. I can feel it. The mornings are getting crisp. I wake up and Drow go, oh, give me a hoodie. Hey, Drow Ranger. All right. We have seen her first band all day. All day. And now
all
in game six, we made it. It's a Drow first pick, baby, for the Witch Doctors.
Oh, what a hero. That's the reason she's first band. You don't even have to do, like, full-out Drow strats anymore, right? That's the thing. Like, back in the day, this hero was just like, okay, it's going to be Drow, and it's going to be Venge, and they'll have one melee offlaner, be it a Tide or, a Faceless Void these days. But now you can go, like, Drow, Venge, and three melee heroes, and no one cares. It's just so ridiculous how much damage this hero does.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes, she does. Yes, she does. I miss the days of Drow Visage, though. I wish somebody would just play it. Just for a throwback.
It used to get banned every time, too.
Yep.
Times. Well, there's an Eldecyton. We talked about this being one of the better heroes up against the Drow Ranger.
Mm-hmm.
Throw that thing right up on top. Give it the old stomp.
A lot of long range there. Some initiation power.
Yep. Stopping the early push, too. Just makes them a little bit hesitant. Axe is still in, which is going to be kind of interesting. I don't know if the Wild Witch Doctors will want it, because it seems like they like running it in a couple different positions.
Might be something they want to ban. Shadow Demon now, second choice for Infamous. Played a big role in the last game. And also a hero you don't really want to just hand over to the team with Drow. That Illusion Harass later on gets really annoying. But Wild Witch Doctors, they'll be happy to scoop up another big core OD to go along with the Drow Ranger.
That's the winning hero, man. Hero wins games. That's what I've learned this tournament.
OD?
Yeah, man. Good stuff. There goes the axe, too. That would have been the trifecta.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, OD doesn't really have problems in lane being a bully, but with the Drow aura, it's all the better. Even more right-click damage.
That was like the second OD game I think I've seen lose. I don't know. I feel like every time I watch this hero, it wins, except for, well, obviously last game, but with the Drow Ranger, it's good. A nice life, man. You get to dominate your mid lane. Drow Ranger plus like any support can pretty much harass out any offlaner, so you start thinking about like going competitive and like going up in like a tri-lane or something, but that's even scary. You're almost wishing you were like Direcide right now with this draft from Infamous. Like where you have that nice good kind of rotating spots the way we've seen SVG play the Elder Titan earlier on today. Kind of rotations and movement is so nice. But coming from the Radiant side, it doesn't really work that way. Like it used to be like Radiant offlane Keeper of the Light plus one used to be able to blast through the trees really nicely, which was a good hero for pressuring. And if you can gain control of that space, then maybe you can do the same thing with the Elder Titan. So as long as the Dire have some decent supports for kind of controlling that area, I feel like Drow's going to have a pretty nice time.
So like, what are the supports we're talking about here? Is Dazzle on our radar?
Yeah, Dazzle's possible. Venge is okay as long as there's like another plus one.
Yeah.
Oh, and Io, that would have been pretty terrifying.
I
but
I think Venge is just good in general because of the double aura strat. I mean, it's always scary to see her paired with a Drow.
10 seconds. It's like, and then it's like Witch Doctor too, right? Kind of same idea.
Okay, so Slardar again. They are going to stick to what they know. King Tekka, we'll see if he can have two good games in a row.
They might.
This is you.
Jug, too, maybe. And go up with Elder Titan, Shadow Demon, Jug. 10 seconds
remaining. Five seconds remaining. Take the Dazzle, boys. Axe has been banned out. I think it's actually a really good game for it. Great to have with the Drow Ranger. I wonder what they want in the offlane. Like, what's the Mike hero now?
Now we've lost our Faces Void. We've lost our Batrider. We've lost our Axe. Mike has no heroes.
Abaddon!
End of the lane.
Please, Mike.
Abaddon or Omni Knight. That's it.
All right, they're going to pick Dazzle here, and then Infamous are going to pick Mirana, and then Wild Witch Doctors will fourth pick Abaddon. That's my call.
Got it, man. That's it. That would be a pretty sick, like, early game tempo kind of a pushing lineup, but in all seriousness, what has Mike been up to these days? We talked about the Enigma, which is really sick with Drow. If he did do something kind of crazy like that, if they went for like this core thing, my god, it's happening, dude.
We're one out of three, all right? The Dazzle, I like it. We've already talked about it. It's just all around good with the Drow, good sustainability, great with the OD, perfect for five man. Just fits exactly what kind of a strategy they want to execute with. And it's a good, like, it's already a support that can kind of zone people out. So with the addition of the Drow aura, Dazzle is actually a really good zoner.
What else? I mean, there's still Timber. Literally only Timber is left in terms of his heroes. It's Timber and Tide.
Timber could be okay here.
Tide would be the more classic kind of a hero to throw in here for sure. Mm-hmm. Like with the early mechanism, groups up with the Drow Ranger strategy.
Yeah. Yeah, we haven't seen much Tide. And then there's Abaddon. Does he not play offlane Abaddon anymore? I always think of that as like the IX Mike thing.
Oh, it was his thing for sure. For a while. He definitely still pubs it, but okay. I think it's not quite as effective. Like,
it's not a pro gaming level.
Yeah, I think we assume that this will be like a Jug or something who goes up
Tinker.
Top. That's nice. Okay, with the Shadow Demon and the Elder Titan. And then that means it would be Slardar versus whatever you want to lane. So like Abaddon could do really well up against that, which would be kind of sick. If not, it's going to be Slardar or Elder Titan in the offlane, and they just try and pressure with two heroes, which will probably be the most likely thing, because I'm not really... I mean, it depends what this other support is for WWD, right? You think that they probably can't fight up into Dazzle, Drow, plus one, three.
Probably not, but I was thinking they might, because the Shadow Demon Slardar is just so damn potent, but you're right. It really does depend on what that next support is. Okay.
Support I don't think Kunkka. I'm going up there.
Yeah, that's like one of the perfect counter initiations to the offensive disruption like that. You get in position to hit him and you just drop a torrent, and old Slardar there won't be having so much fun.
The other thing is, like, now Slardar just can't go up there, so maybe you do have to fight into the... Oh, they just banned the clockwork.
Oh, the clockwork. Mike. There you go. That could have been a viable pick. I mean, maybe Darkseer, he's still in it.
I mean, he was into a Tinker, too, so it would have been pretty sick. But, yeah, Darkseer buying the Blink and the Vacuum. That's true, but, man, I haven't seen Mike play Darkseer in a while. 5 seconds remaining. Comical.
I'm really curious what they're going to give Mike. I want to know.
Abaddon seems awful now up against Tinker, unless you're going full push. But this is, like, game number three. It is winner's bracket, so I guess you don't lose, but...
Trying to think of a ranged hero that he could play to make use of the Drow aura, but
I mean, the only one the clowny one is like Wind Ranger, but obviously that's not going to happen in a competitive
Wind Ranger.
That's the only one I ever see is like in these random like JDL matches and shit. They go like offlane Wind Ranger because he's like so good with the Drow aura, but it's not going to happen.
Tide Hunter. The Tide Hunter. All right, Bander. Tide. I like it. I'm glad. I think this is, of all the heroes we rattled off, I think this is one of the better ones. Like it really fills in what this draft was lacking. Like, they have damage, they've got push, they've got sustainability, and this is their big AoE disable team fight that kind of holds it all together. You know, Tide is the glue that holds, he's the rug that holds the room, ties the room together.
Traditionally, he was like the offlaner with Drow, because he builds mech, groups up, early put, like he times up nicely, and there's the Juggernaut too. So they're going in, baby.
All right. Well, Tinker definitely a good choice against a Drow Strat in general. He'll be able to defend. They have a pretty good just defensive lineup. Elder Titan, kind of notorious for his ability to defend high ground, you know, delay things like Roche and tower pushing with the Echo Stomp Spirit Spam. Sardar, also pretty good at high ground defense with his Blink AoE Crush. It could work out for Infamous here. It's all about momentum, I feel like. These Drow
strats
are... All
about that laning stage, man.
Yeah.
Tough. It's very tough. Dazzle and Kunkka. But if you get one quick kill, Shadow Demon, Elder Titan, Juggernaut, right? We saw it last game. If they actually get Disruption on someone, and maybe the Grave, like, if he... You have to be really close to Grave. So if you come in for that Grave, if you do it too early, they're going to immediately switch onto you, and then you'll just be dead as the Dazzle. Mm-hmm. So needs to be some pretty crisp play here from the Dire side.
All right.
But then, if they get it, that Snowball's pretty easy rolling, eh?
Yeah, I think that's the... The whole point of the drow, right? You win the lanes, you knock down a few towers, then use that momentum to just win the game. So here we go. What it really comes down to, the cosmetics game on Tide. What are we looking at here, Mike? The Naval Mine, the Flood Mask, okay. And the Hammer Time Rare Fish Club from 2012. It's an okay Tide Hunter set. He's got the backstroke. That's really what's important. I hope he
buys. Yeah, I made a sandwich in between games, so.
Oh, good.
Yeah, I'm just working on that.
I ate a Cliff Bar. I also ate noodles in between series, but then I dropped my chopsticks, so now I can't finish them.
I went on my honeymoon. This has to do with Cliff Bars. Thankfully, there's a pause so I can tell my boring stories. I love these. We went on our honeymoon. We went to Quebec, and where we're going for this land.
You went to Quebec on your honeymoon? You're like... Where do you want to go, man? Love? I don't know. Yeah. How about you, love? Let's go hang out with the Frenchies. Okay, love. Was that
pretty much?
Okay, I like it.
We went to Quebec City because we went there for skiing a lot. But it was in the summer this time, so we like hiked up Mont Saint-Anne and stuff, blah, blah, blah. But anyway, we stay in this beautiful little B&B kind of place, and lovely old lady who's running it.
Mm-hmm.
She asked us because she found out we were going hiking. She's like, do you guys have any bars with you? Like these like, you know, cliff bars, right? Mm-hmm. And we're like, no. She goes, oh, you need them. My daughter makes them. Turns out her daughter owns a gluten-free, organic, all-natural bar-making company. It wasn't Cliff Bars. It was like a knockoff brand.
Okay.
Oh, my God. So she's like, no, you should take some. She throws like 8 in our bag. And we're like, oh, great. I'm like, fucking big. So we take them. They taste like dog shit. Like, they were like the worst things I've ever had. There's actually one in my bag. There was one in my bag for a year and a half. Because I kept forgetting about it and then laughing every time I saw it. And then I'd leave it in there. And when we leave the place, she put them on our bill. She charged us for these fucking shitty-ass organic bars. She charged us like $4 a bar. I wasn't too happy, but she was super nice, so I just pretended it was a tip.
Wow. Okay, that's good. So you just mentally wrote it off.
Man.
We tipped her in Nutri-Grain bar purchases.
Cliff bar crap thing. Oh, my God, dude. They were like fossilized poop. You should have seen these things. There was one that was called chocolate. It tastes like dirt, dude.
Veganism. Rocks. So,
totally the highlight of the honeymoon. Although her B&B had a room with a hot tub in it. I mean, that was I'm surely a ventilation issue. But back to Dota 2.
All right. Well, that raises the bar for my expectations for my honeymoon. That's good. Radiant, look at... Now, this is atypical here, Trent. This Wardy up here above Roche at 0-0. You don't see that one too often.
Yeah, what are we rocking here? I guess they assume it's IX Mike. They haven't gone up to contest, right? So they're not going up to fight the drow. They're going to send old Slider out to the wolves. Good luck, buddy. But that means they definitely want to be putting pressure on IX. Oh, IX Mike Dota. He must have caught it with this, did he?
IX Mike where?
He got that ward, dude. That thing is
did
done.
He? Oh, my God. How did he know?
It. I assume they walked past this or something. Oh. Or they like came back down through here.
Okay.
It's probably this was here and they went into Roche and did the Roche play.
Yeah, the classic. So Mike goes Iron Talon just immediately into the jungle on Tide. One of the heroes that can get away with this. Not the fastest jungler, but it's not that bad either. And if left uncontested, I mean, he'll be able to get up that nice timely mech before too long. Slardar with the exact same idea.
Really smart by him too.
But look at Eagle. Just leeching the XP. This is actually
both
not so bad for the Dazzle.
Yeah, like both of them know they can't do anything in lane, right? You're just going to die to this Kunkka Drow. Like, what are you going to do? Slow is very good up against just Slardar, right? X into Torrent into some Frost Arrows, so life would be awful. Similarly for IX Mike, he knows that since they're not contesting top with this Juggernaut, that means the supports are looking for someone to kill, and he's going to be the prime opportunity. Certainly saw the intent with that ward there. And then he knows that despite having done that, he can't go back to this hard camp, or Elder Titan's just going to come up on in here. We've seen Elder Titan do that time and time again. So he's forced all the way back into his own jungle, and that puts the pressure onto mid. So we get Dazzle mid with an OD. with a Tinker with a Shadow Demon and an Elder Titan. So kind of a fun little laning stage for us here.
Yeah, very atypical lane setup here. Dazzle's very committed to the cause. He hits his level 2. And again with the Drow Aura, they can afford to sort of trade hits and get a little added efficiency. Now the Astral Spirit may be a bit more annoying than planned, but... Looking at the jungle, King Tekka has moved into deep into his own territory, where Eagle can't steal his experience. Pretty chaotic mid lane. Spells flying like crazy. It's like between the Astral Spirit and the Shadow Poison, it's the sound effect game here from Infamous is pretty 10 out of 10.
Much like my sandwich game.
How's this Tide doing? Level 3, Ix Mike, 2 points in the Kraken Shell, easy peasy, over the hump. This Tide's a farming. The Tide does definitely farm a lot faster than the Slardar.
Yes, quite a bit, so. Good old Anchor Smash.
Yeah. You'll see the Slardar has to scurry his way back to the well. That's not the case for old Mike here. He's sitting there in his basketball shorts, just killing those tomatoes and potatoes. Dude, I have met Mike in person several times. He has worn basketball shorts at every encounter. I saw him, was it TI4? He ordered new basketball shorts off Amazon so he could throw his dirty ones away and still have clean basketball shorts. Just had him shipped to the hotel straight up. No judgment.
Seattle Amazon, dude.
I'm just saying.
But yeah, now he went for the 0-2-1 build, so slightly slower, but you don't have to go back home at that point.
Yeah.
He gives him one value Iron Town before he now heads back, as that is a pretty scary camp. Been with 2 points in Kraken.
Mm-hmm. So old Juggernaut, free farming, number one on CS, but similar deal for the Drow Ranger here in the safe lane, Mr. Boris. Looks like the Dire side... I thought they had a small advantage, but it's pretty much zeroed out. King Tekka's gone back to lane now. Only level 3.
Playing this pretty risky. He doesn't know that there's no X on Kunkka. So he has to play like this, even though theoretically he could be up closer. But mm-hmm. It means that the farming efficiency for Jubei is even better. So that's a really nice play by him.
Yeah.
Getting the most out of his hero right now, but still instills that threat inside the Slardar that he has to just sit here and soak.
Mid lane. How is the OD doing against the Tinker? It's actually kind of a wash. Both sides with a lot of support. There's been a lot more pressure on denying each other than actually finding farm for themselves. Both of them with a pretty high amount of denies.
That's kind of a cool matchup. Just like fast finger kind of thing, right? Like who gets the Astral off, who gets the laser off, working the angles, having vision super important. So the fact that this Observer Ward's down here is really going to help out the Dire side.
Both sides have Observers down, actually.
Yeah.
True. Oh, up top. What are we looking at here? Kunkka setting it up. Gust on 3 from the Drow Ranger. Nice set of silence, and they will just disengage. Pretty big rotation from Infamous, bringing the 2 supports to join Mr. Slardar.
Oh, Mike's still in the jungle. Too scared to go down bottom, which means total free from here for Benhaus. Life is good, man.
Yeah.
Pressure onto the tower.
He'll just move into the Aquila. I mean, Mike is getting pretty good experience, though. He's halfway through 5. You compare that to the Slardar, he's only at the beginning of 4. So I think this sacrifice has been worth it. It'll TP down now and leech some of the XP that's just coming into the tower. Also, repel the Jug from trying to knock it down.
The fact that there's levels now on the Infamous supports was really nice, too, though, because they were able to come up here and they actually had an impact. They were able to drive the Drow back a little bit. They gave some room over to King Tekka for more farms, so he can hopefully have another fantastic game here on his Slardar. Good.
6 minutes, 0 kills. The latest in NA Dota.
Run into Pusher.
Pusher.
Is there anything up here?
Who sets up on who? Now Stinger looking for the Echo. He's got the mana just barely. It gets interrupted by the Torrent.
Yo.
What a clutch timing.
Damn, dude. And then the turnaround there with the 2 points, 2 points Torrent and then into the Tidebringer. See that damage.
Wow. Dude, that Torrent, I thought that Stomp was about to go off. I don't think it gets much closer than that in terms of interrupting that cast point.
It's
Sayori should not make fun of basketball shorts. He wears leggings.
I just saw that. Hey, I wear my share of basketball shorts.
That was pretty good. That was good.
shout out to you, dude.
Oh, are you giving a shout? Oh, okay.
To Code Monkey X and to you.
Code Monkey X. I thought you were giving a shout out to the guy named Zayori Sniffbot. I was about to be like, whoa, Trent, that's over the line. Okay. I thought thought you and I were on the same team here. Oh, my. When's the first blood? Let's take an over-under here. 9 minutes. What
I don't
do you
know.
Got?
They have been some seriously late first blood today. I feel like I blame that on our slight distractions because they've been some really late first bloods.
Yeah. 7 minutes is pretty. They're pushing it.
I would say 9 minutes.
You think nine on the dot? Over? You got to pick over under. That's the whole.
Yeah, I know. I'm going to pick under.
Under nine. Okay.
What do you think?
I'll take the over. 90 seconds? I don't know. Everybody's just farming. Mike's. Look at him. He's just walking around in circles. He's chilling.
Look at Pusher, though. He's ready. He's going to do something here.
It's true. He does look kind of ready to die. He gets a ward down.
Nice, Warden.
This is what Merlini and I used to do when games were boring. We would just start doing over-unders on things for obscure bets.
It's a good way to pass the time.
Merlini's a pocket gambler, in case y'all didn't know. So if you ever bump into him, that's the way
make,
to his
make
heart.
A bet with him. Make
over-unders.
Uh-oh. Italy, so close.
50 seconds up top. Some pressure on the tier 1. Drow starting to come online a little bit. She's level 7. Has the gold for the Dragon Lance. It's the first step. All these defensive TPs home.
Damn, dude. 8.5 minutes Dragon Lance. It's pretty nice.
Kataro's a legit troll, though, man. The amount of people in chat that have been like, oh my god, is that actually ZSMJ?
Abandoned LGD ZSMJ?
Has he relocated to South America? To play with South America's finest? No, it's Kataro, guys. He's just having fun with his name. Oh, boy.
All right, well, I
Mike's
lost.
Got a stack here. Yep. Well, it was a good try. So Mike's
I
got
had more faith in Shadow Demon.
A 4 stack, it looks like. Yeah, there you go. He's got it. Now smoke up with Admiral Kunkka.
Already envisioned. They just saw the stack happen. But they aren't aware that the aggression is coming in here.
Oh,
Ravage.
Tinker, the perfect one to catch with the smoke. It's broken. They hesitate. And Kataro should see it. It's daytime. Yeah, he definitely sees him.
Benhaus is still just punching creeps, dude. Like, this is pretty nice for him. I feel like every time I'm expecting something to happen, like that kind of a smoke gank play,
yeah.
But then you're going in on top of a Juggernaut, so that's always going to be a little bit riskier compared to a Tinker. He'd love to be shutting down before those bots come online.
Yep.
But not so. And those are them now, eh? Oh, imagine they got that gank. Would have been so good.
Coming on 10 minutes. OD again. It's a mech OD. Dude, we saw a mech Razor, and is this 2 mech ODs today?
Yeah.
Envy did it earlier.
Right, the mech pipe.
Dude, the old days are back.
We're in. But, so, he's getting mechs. Mike. So, oh, Mike could just get pipe, actually. That would be really good this game.
Oh, yeah.
I still don't think you go blink.
Straight
I mean,
pipe against the Tinker. I don't think blink first is bad, but there is definitely merit to going first item pipe against Tinker with a Drow. That 5-man, when you want to knock down these towers, the
yeah,
early
exactly.
pipe is devastating. But they start to contest the stack. Mike's already gotten the bulk of it, but Eagle tanks the Omni Slash. That's an easy first blood at 10.5 minutes. Way over.
Sleep set up there just to be able to get that freebie on the
desk. Oh, nicely done with Kunkka's Torrent. All right, back to the Ancients we go. Farm, farm, farm. So Mike's now up to 1600.
I'm getting seriously worried about this Juggernaut, though. Like, he had, the freest farm you can get, quite literally. No one in his lane. And then he just shows up, gets an instant Omni Slash kill, and is back to punching creeps.
Yeah, he's gone for the Yasha, and I think now he just transitions into the Battle Fury and keeps this farm going. Snowball it, baby. Blink Dagger on Slardar at 11 minutes. We were relishing at the difficulties King Tekko is having farming, and this is actually a great blink timing for an offlane Slardar. This is really not too bad.
Yeah, he did an excellent job of reading the supports. He didn't die in that lane, which is pretty ridiculous. I mean, they played a little bit greedy with the Kunkka and everything. It helped out from the super nice wards put in from the bottom lane. And then again, Pusher, that one in the mid lane, spotting a lot of those rotations from the Dazzle and stuff. Mm-hmm. Just knowing where he could push his limits is great. Dude. But, like, there were 4 points Frost Arrows on Boris. He hasn't even used them yet, but that Slardar was dead if he went in lane, dude. Like, completely dead. 64% slow.
Yeah.
He ain't living.
This Dazzle is, like, Soup Kitchen Central, man.
This is some eagle, dude.
400 net worth at 12 minutes.
What's his GPM? 122.
At least he's in the triple digits club. I mean, that's something. True. That's but before that tower, he might not have been. It was a big bump. Well, he's got a smoke. They're about to use his only item.
There goes that net worth, dude.
Tide has a blink dagger, though.
Dude, he has...
It's kind of like he is. People talk about PPD being that ultra sacrificial five, but Eagle is like on another level. This guy is just always. It's like he doesn't even think about farming. He's just like, no, just you do it. Oh, Benjaz. See ya.
Later.
Good try. Instead, just a tier one tower push mid. Boris with the damage here.
I mean, the mech's there, boyos.
A defense from Infamous. Mike comes in with a Ravage on two. Follow-up boat. It's a fail boat, but that's okay. They could still find one. King Tekka caught in the Astral. Ravage on five. King Tekka lives.
Yeah, he had to recount. I wasn't sure. They all just grouped up?
Dude, he hit more heroes with his Ravage than the real Ravage. That's an 8-second cooldown. Now here we go. Another stun on two. That's a dead Dazzle, OD, and Kunkka. Three down for the count. Infamous, turn it around.
All right, so this is what happens. This is if you go for the blink or you go for the pipe. If you go for the pipe, it's a slow siege style. It's harder to execute. You can get punished heavier by split pushing heroes, but probably more likely to succeed over time. Or you go for this blink, which is that giant play into the back lines. Go for the Ravage, and that's what Mike went for, and they almost had it. But what? Did he not come out of Astral and stun? Is that not what happened?
I guess not.
Was it Disrupt? I mean, it was either Disrupt or Astral, and then he stunned, but, like...
It was weird.
Shouldn't they have known? Maybe he blinked in and I just missed it. I thought he came out of an Astral or something, because there's, like, no way you should stun five heroes out of
King
one of those
Tekka.
Things,
he will be punished. Maybe. Oh, he just barely lives.
Dude, he's
Boris.
Going back in.
He doesn't have the damage. He's just regenning up. He's got the crush.
Someone get this guy an armlet. Like, I just want full out King Tekka now.
King Tekka. Dude, this guy, man. We need, like, we need a command that you can type in just to see how many heroes have been hit by crush. You know, just so you get, like, the crush counter.
Oh, like the old Pudge Hook thing?
Yeah. Or kind of like, you know, there used to be the with Luna at the end, you have the beam count. It would tell you how many Lucent beams you've had because, like, your ult goes crazy and you spam it out. It's the same, like... How many times has someone been stunned by Slithering Crush? You know, you hit all five, that counts as five. I want a raw, it's like a Slardar meter.
Well, someday, you know, make a Reddit thread. Might happen. That's all I can say.
Uh-oh.
He's going to find King Tekka. This is quite the adventurous position. Team?
It really is. I mean, luckily for him, Infamous are nowhere nearby, so he just walks through and they'll finish off the tower. Boris will get that one. I can't believe Slardar lived in that last fight, though. Boris, you better be careful. He's got the Hurricane Pike, so he can afford
this guy's unkillable.
Slightly more aggressive position. Okay. So Juggernaut gets a free tower down bottom. What's coming out on that courier? It's a Manta. He skips the Battle Fury. Okay,
I think this is just because of the Drow lineup and everything. And like the Silence coming in, too, is huge as well. But he knows they want to fight, right? They have like a Blink Tide. Man, this is crazy. King Tekka, dude. I love this guy.
Here we go, up top. Oh, he gets initiated on, though. They catch him.
He's blinking right before it lands, though, from the Hurricane Pike. The Gush, this case, but...
Oh, whoops, all right. Elder Titan gets caught there. It's an easy one. Pusher. What are you doing?
We're good. Some good wards, some creep pulling.
Okay.
He's delaying the push. He did it.
That's actually pretty good. They've got a couple of creeps. They still finish off the tower. The two pretty aggressive wards they've got down. Oh, down bottom. Omni Slash on WWD. Should still be a dead OD, I think. Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Dude, Infamous are doing this. Mm-hmm. Yo, Tekka's on it. It's a 4K net worth lead. 3,500 experience lead. I feel like we haven't checked in on Kotaro in a while, but he's got himself Blink to go with his BOT Soul Ring.
I feel like we haven't checked in on a Juggernaut or Kotaro this game, and they've both just been farming the whole time, but they're still up in kills somehow. Like, almost 10K gold on that Juggernaut.
I mean, aside from that
impressively so too.
One whiffed fight mid where King Tekka just rolled all over his keyboard, we haven't really seen a great 5v5 like demonstration of what the Drow strat is all about, right? I mean, that was the only Ravage we've seen, and now Boris up top, he's getting slapped around by King Tekka. It's another one for the Slardar. You do it, Slardar.
Like the anti-caster curse. Just start praising a guy, and he just goes crazy.
Dude, this guy is actually breaking this game wide open, and now he's out farming the OD.
He's going to have a four step. How are they going to kill him? He's going to have to get ravaged.
OD's actually starting to fall really far behind. He's lowest of the cores. He's on Brown Boots mech with 1,500 gold.
Well, that's the thing, right? He went mech.
This is one of the drawbacks of going mech on OD. It's like really good for those five-mans when you're that like bulwark just standing there with all of your support cast around you and they can't kill you. But when you're in this kind of split up one at a time, it's just... It feels lackluster. Having the mobility of like a four staff provides you so much more survivability. You know, the mech's great for five man, but individually you need that four staff.
Yeah, and they haven't been five manning is the whole point too.
Yeah,
it's gonna
exactly.
be sick for this Roche fight at the very least. Like, they can use this. Not much of a fight, I guess, when it's just 1v1, you know, you guys versus Roche, but can you imagine if they smoke and found them at the pit right now?
Oh god.
Can you imagine if King Tekka knew they were there?
Dude, if they go pit right now.
This is it.
Oh, they're getting out of there.
WWD.
Do they have scan?
Shadow Amulet on the high ground. The smoke gets broken. This is actually pretty smart from Boris. I like the use of the Shadow Amulet. They catch Stinger with it. Good setup for the Wild Witch Doctors here.
All right, yeah, that was really nice. Good positioning there by Mr. Boris. And there's the buyback. They know, man. They don't want to give up an Aegis to a Drow lineup. Not worth it.
Oh, Tekka jumps in onto Boris. Again, good use of the Shadow Amulet. Do they know he's there? They should, right? So buyback on the Elder Titan. They actually move into the Roche themselves. And with the Slardar, I mean, the amp damage makes Roche fall more quickly, but they need to be kind of careful here. There is a Ravage and a Sanity's Eclipse. I don't think Infamous want to just walk into the pit. That feels like a very risky proposition. This is a good old-fashioned stalemate here, Trent. Neither side can easily just jump on in.
So, we wait. But, yeah, the buyback's worth it, I think, from ET. Just to make sure they don't secure that. And a stalemate... Well, I mean, draw lineups don't fall off as heavy as they did in the past, but I think a stalemate still favors Infamous just because of this like itemization on the OD and everything, like this mech and whatnot.
And I think it also it favors them because they have a Tinker who can actually split farm and then just come back at any stage, whereas WWD are actually grouped up as five, just kind of killing the Ancients where they're lingering about. So I think Infamous are definitely just getting more efficiency out of this weird game of chicken around the pit.
So nice with the spirit too. So easy for them to keep tabs on it. The only way it would be better if they had like a TA trap or something, but of course that can be dealt with, whereas spirit you cannot kill.
Mm-hmm. Dazzle. 750 net worth. On the up and up.
Less than random gold.
What a way to look at it.
He's behind, dude.
When are they going to add AR to ranked?
Oh, what used to be in ranked? It wasn't AR, it was...
Was it single draft? No, is single draft still in ranked?
No.
No,
was it single draft?
Yeah, I think it was single draft.
Yeah, because
Right now, it's...
Oh, no, wait. It was random drafts, no longer in ranked. That's what it was. Because now it's only... Isn't ranked only random or captain's mode and...
No, you can do random draft right now. There's three.
Oh, okay.
It's all pick captain's mode, random draft is what it is right now. I think it was SD.
Yeah, it was single.
I really like AR. I can't stand playing unranked Dota, but AR is one of my favorite game modes, man. It's so fun.
Yeah, all random's great. Because you get to, like... It's like playing Dota for the first time again, kind of.
Yeah.
Where, like, you didn't know everything, and you get to be, like, I don't know.
Well, it's fun
weird,
because
like,
it...
OD support or
and it puts
shit.
You on, like, equal footing, because a lot of times the other team, it's like, oh my god, look at their lineup. It's like, yeah, but what are the chances all five of them know how to play those five specific heroes, right? So, usually leads to fun, lopsided games anyway. I digress here. Resume. 6-3 in 21 minutes. Farm War continues. Four staff up on IX Mike. Infamous, though, hanging on to their lead up to about 7,500 net worth. Their two big cores at the top. Old Juggernaut. Battle Fury inbound. He's damn close, too.
Feels like the Dire are going to be pretty desperate for a good pickoff here, eh? You know? Come on in with the pickoff. Get Roche and push into these towers. Would be so good for them right now. Make use of this Blink 4 staff on Mike. This mechanism on your OD. They want to fight. They want to go into objectives. They're tired of farming. I think their game plan, they're up against a Tinker. It's scary. Boris is like trying to stalk him up here with the Shadow Blade, hoping he's going to show up. But he ain't coming, man.
What do you got, Boris? Shadow Blade now. Okay, interesting. Another mobility tool on the Drow. We saw it work really well on Faceless Void in a number of games earlier. And as we know, Drow, one of those heroes that pretty much positioning is the name of the game. That's...
Oh, they're going to find a great moment here. Everyone's on the other side of the map right now for the Radiant. It's
oh,
just the two supports.
Oh, Glimmer Capes. He's, well, okay for now.
Oh. Like,
and the sandwich.
Hello? Everyone else left? Can you imagine if he got away after everyone else left?
No, they were just like, you know what, Eagle? You've been a little too broke this game. Let's give you some money, buddy. And they wanted him to
have
a kill.
There must be more heroes here. He's actually all alone.
There must be more heroes. Dazzle, you can stay and finish him off. We're all going to get out of here. Okay, well, meanwhile, Infamous doing some split push. Ben Jazz here in the mid, putting a lot of pressure on that tier 2, while the Wild Witch Doctors head right into the Roche pit. All five there. It does get scouted out, though. Echo Stomp could slow this down quite a bit. They split. It puts only Roche to sleep.
Oh, my God. If King Tekka steals this, I'm just done with Dota forever. He's dropping the Knight of Doom. He's dropped the TP. Let's go.
King Tekka for life, baby. This is it.
They see him. He's there.
Tekka's in. He drops the stun. Roche getting low, but he's the only one in the pit. Kunkka throws the boat over. Roche dies to the Dire, picked up by Drow, and this time King Tekka cannot make the godlike plays. His team, they leave him out high and dry. And that's
that
it.
That was way too ambitious, dude. I love him, though.
I mean, I think that ambition could have worked if there was, like, a simultaneous, the whole team jumps in there and tries to go ham, but that was, like... The captain saying, guys, we don't want to contest this. Just hand it over. And Tekka saying, don't worry, guys. I'm going to snipe the Aegis. That's what it looked
like
to me.
Either I get Aegis or they burn Ravage. Yeah. It's going to be fine. And he just gets voted. And he's like, shit.
So, I mean, they weren't even close. Like, all they were surrounding it. They were just like, nope, he's dead. We're out of here. And, yeah, ambitious is definitely the word. Mike was able to save his Ravage. Even Sanity's Eclipse still okay. That's a Hurricane Pike now up on the OD. So... Another round of core items do come out for the Wild Witch Doctors, giving them a sign of life. I am still really nervous about this Jug. He was number one on net worth before the Battle Fury, and now he's picked up a Blink in tandem with that new shiny Cleaver.
Pretty much the ideal scenario here. Like, yeah, he went in towards that early Yasha just because, you know, you farm pretty fast with that too. He wasn't sure where they were moving around on the map. He knew that there could have been battles and fights, so he goes into the Manta, make sure he won't get silent stuff, make sure he has spin available if he's going to be chained up from, like, X marks the spot into everything else. Just give himself that innate survivability as Stinger goes down top to Boris, but...
Nice little solo
going
pick.
Back in the Battle Fury is great. Like, farms up quick, very fast, able to take Ancients because of it. Oh, yeah. Super quick, so he's already up to the Blink Dagger. Being ahead with that late of a Blink... Or Battle Fury compared to his Tinker is pretty crazy. King Tekka will be the next victim, and this is going to be a great push mid for the Dire.
Tic-tac Tekka.
They've learned their lesson after the Astral. They go this far, you know, away. Not getting five-man crushed out of Astral.
Oh, God. Yeah, that five-man crush is one of those, like, oh, I wish I had the replay buffer going. Holy shit, that's a replay moment right there. But I think something that we haven't really talked about in a while that...
He blinks on the Boris. Oh, there's not enough damage.
Is this up top? Oh, the Tinker. Okay. Like,
he blinked right on the Boris's head.
Oh, okay. But now that this jug is so big, the Shadow Demon Illusion Harass will be something that... It's going to be a real threat soon. I mean, Jug isn't at that point yet where the illusions are crazy, but if he gets a Scotty next item, for example, that's where they can start to slow siege high ground, chip away at these tier threes, and I mean, that's not easy for any team to deal with. WWD have a great lineup for that all-in, okay, this is the fight, Mike, blow the Ravage, but for that little bit of chip damage harassment, that's not something they can as easily deal with.
Yeah, they don't have great long-range wave player unless you get, like, right Kunkka or something.
Yeah. Hasn't been a threat until now. Also, oh, golly. Poor Dazzle, man.
Dude, that's an Aghanim Scepter.
That's an Aghanim Scepter with an Aether Lens. It's even worse.
The pain.
Pain train. Oh, man, a Shadow... Man, these OD builds really are wide open. Mech,
yeah,
Hurricane Pipe,
nice,
Shadow Blade. Okay.
It's better, like, it at least gives you stuff compared to a Blink, but it's still going to help them aid in this whole, like, Tinker stuff. Plus, their initiation is kind of weak overall. It's just Mike.
Mm-hmm. So this gives them the ability to catch somebody with an Astral now in the back line, have Drow start off with a Silence.
And you can also, like, play around, like, Invis, too. Like, even if you're, like, walking in Shadow Blading and there is a Sentry and you get jumped on, that still is providing an initiation opportunity. You know what I mean? Like... The fact that you are able to press forward in a somewhat safe scenario still means that, like, it's not the same as just walking a hero down, because when you just walk a hero down, that's just bait. But when you're walking down with just a Shadow Blade, that's an idiot looking for a pickoff. That's what you think, but it's actually a bait. Aha!
Aha! Ahoy!
Ahoy!
BKB up on King Tekka, and Silver Edge upgraded for Boris here. Not a bad game for it. Not the best game for Break, but I think that damage mitigation on a hero like Jug is really significant.
This is really interesting. Going for the BKB over the Force Staff this time from King Tekka. I really like it, because he knows, again, they need to fight right now, and the longer this game goes, the more they just keep tinkering. So BKB it is.
Mike walks right into it, but Force Staff to the high ground. Tekka...
Oh, yo, the Yukes!
He pulls the trigger on the BKB and does not find much in return. That is a lackluster 10-second charge if I've ever seen one.
Oh, this is Mike YOLO. YOLO. Would have been pretty hard to find Tinker post-Ravage.
Yeah. It should really, like, knock him up in the air above the trees so you can see him for a second, you know? Like, he becomes visible because he's so high in the air.
Who owns these tentacles, too? Like, shouldn't they give him some vision? Right? Like, they're kind of
Would that
friendly.
Be really broken if Ravage gave you, like, the clear vision of where the tentacles are? I don't know if that would be a...
Just for the instant it happens?
Yeah, like, while they're on the field. It feels like an unnecessary buff. I don't know if it would be really that
yeah, it's probably just an unnecessary buff.
It would only be good in, like, weird situations like that where you could use it as, like, impromptu weave, and if you catch him with a stun, then you could set up...
We'd probably see a lot more whiffed Ravages when people go for YOLO plays.
Yeah, that's true.
So I'm all in favor.
So is it really a buff? Oh,
yeah, God. Because these Ravages are just going on cooldown at completely inopportune times because they're like, no, it gives vision. We can follow up. I got this.
But guys, I saw the ward on the high ground.
Radiant are here. Dire are here. What will happen? It's like one of those moments you pause it in What the Horse.
Yep.
Your favorite show provided to you by DC. Not affiliated with Mundo.
Oh, the pusher gets jumped on by Boris, but King Tech is there. Pops the BKB. Mike blows the Ravage, but where's the follow-up? Boris getting low, gets popped the grave. I don't think it's going to do a hell of a lot, though. It does allow the Shadow Demon to fall. OD saves his friend. Now he goes down. It looks like a good fight for Infamous. A fast 1-for-2. Now Mike blinking through the trees. Kunkka doing the same. They'll try to disengage. Kunkka gets scouted but makes it out. Mike will not be so lucky. That big fat watermelon body of his gets chopped up and put in a bowl, 1-for-3. Big fight for Infamous. It is starting to feel like this hurdle may be too big for WD to climb. That fight was pretty convincing. It was a really nice grave from the Dazzle, but it seemed like it just delayed the inevitable. Like, they can keep the Drow alive for a long time, but they still don't have the damage to actually shut down the Jug or the Sardar.
Yeah, this is that lineup, again, that's built for, like, these big 5-on-5 engagements and walking to towers and stuff, and they're taking this one where you don't get that perfect Ravage where you know they're setting up defensively and Mike has that clear line of sight. Instead, he has to Ravage a BKB Slaughter. Not the dream.
King Tekka going in, making some space, distracts the Dazzle. Kataro gives him the laser to the backside. Now out comes the Astral, tier 3 taking a lot of damage. Kunkka boat flying overhead. But now they just initiate. Tekka pops the BKB. Say goodnight to your Outworld Devourer as well as your Kunkka. 3 in the grave, only 1 with buyback,
dude,
and it is indeed.
King Tekka, he's thinking about it.
There's the buyback now. OD. Ready to mount the defense. Mike does not have Ravage. It's down for 50. Now they turn the other way. Stomp. Benjaz going ham. Second force staff. Boris pops out of the well. Oh, God, this Tinker. He is going ham on this dire squad. Boris survives as he makes it to the high ground. Now Shadow Demon with the reset. WWD completely pushed back into their well. Buyback now from the Tide. Mike still doesn't have the Ravage. King Tekka on the run. Astral. But he might have a crush. He does have a crush. He connects on 2 and runs right into the Drow. But hey, it's all right. Space created. Now Barracks going down. They got the melee range still standing. It's still a big fight for Team Infamous. They get 2 buybacks out of it all. That's not the recap I was hoping for. But yeah, look at that gold graph, baby. Oh, South America. Dreams are coming true. Winner of this is moving on to the winner bracket finals against NP.
Ooh,
that's Infamous. Exciting. If they win this, they are not that far away from qualifying to go to Montreal.
Ooh. Yeah, dude. Man, like, this whole game is pretty much summed up in the fact that Tinker and Jug have not died. It's just, they've done whatever they wanted the whole game. I have never felt fearful for their lives. Not even once.
That's true.
That's not good, man. With a Jug and a Tinker, like, that is super. Those are 2 heroes that can't just be free farming the entire time. They just join up with their team and.
Dude, you can feel it on the net worth too. I mean, they are leagues ahead now at this point. Look at the inventories, and it's a big difference. Jug's got the full Scotty, so now we're at the point where the illusions are actually really beefy and do a fair bit of damage. Also, in the Radiant Jungle, Boris needs to be a little careful. BKB coming out for him, it looks like. Still, ways off.
They find Eagle. No TP. Oh, he has the gem. That would actually be so bad. Oh, do they not see him? Oh my god. Feels so happy right now.
What a play. He doesn't have a TP either. He's like, all right, just don't move.
I'm chilling here.
Don't breathe.
I have the gem. God, if he comes out right now back at the center, though. Oh, no.
Oh, no. Eagle.
Oh, they saw him. They saw him.
Run. Run, you little biscuit.
Oh, he's dead. The gem.
No. He gets off the shallow grave. He weaves him.
King Tekka, look at him.
All right. Oh, that's a dazzle down. Yeah, that hurts. Feels like close to a, maybe not a final straw, but yet another morale blow to this dire squad.
Oh, and they find Roche too. And now Tinker caught up by WWD. He sells the Hurricane Pike.
Uh-oh.
Oh.
Kataro. Oh, what a blink. Okay, now WWD is dead, and that is a heartbreaking turn.
So he blinked still into range of the ulti, but it didn't kill.
Okay, so it actually made no difference. I thought it just juked it, and then I realized
he
had no mana.
It did mean he didn't get the second right click off, because if he was still closer, he wouldn't have had to turn his body, and he might have still died. So
it's still a good blink, but yeah, I thought he dodged the full Sanity's Eclipse at first. My bad. And we'll see a suicide in the Roche pit. Kunkka jumps into his death, but Tide snatches the Aegis. Oh my, IX Mike. It'll probably cost him his life, but he force stabs up to the high ground. Grave from the Dazzle. Now they jump in as ZSMJ cosplay joins the party. Tide falls. No buybacks on the 4 dead heroes. It was a last ditch effort. A noble one at that. But Boris, no, not like this.
Oh, mercy. They have mercy on Boris. They're letting him live. Stacking his items, throwing out the taunt.
GG. All right.
Viva Peru.
Viva Peru. So we will have NP versus Team Infamous in the winner bracket finals. WWD now going down to the lower bracket. No elimination in this series, of course. So they will live to fight another day, but a tough series. They looked so good in game one. Game two, definitely more scrappy. Infamous was able to squeak out a win. In game three, very convincing for the Radiant squad, man. Like you
first
said.
First pick, Drow.
First pick, Drow. Ben Jazz and Kataro both undefeated. No deaths, just easy peasy games. 350 CS on each. I mean, they just got everything they wanted.
It was like the game just kind of broke down. It's like we had the Mech OD. Like you saw what was supposed to happen. Mech OD, Blink Tide. And then there was like Dragonlance and a little bit more Agi stacked up with this Drow. And it was like, all right, boys, we're going down mid. It's time to bring this Tinker in and this Jug. We're going to force him to fight us and we're going to win. And then just one botched fight mid and they never quite found their groove. Then the Roche fight, again, that was huge too from Infamous, right? With those buybacks from the Elder Titan and everything, just to make sure they couldn't secure that and be a Drow lineup. Because at any time that goes wrong, you lose a ton of buildings. Like, the push is going to be insane.
Yeah. Wow, what a day of Dota, Trent. Both series going, all three games, 6-1. This is a long broadcast. That's good stuff. Just got word from the admins. We will not be having any games tomorrow. There's been a reschedule. I think it has to do with WESG and the qualifiers as such.
Canada.
So go Canada. Yep, go USA. A lot of fun teams in that event, but it will screw up the schedule for tomorrow. So keep your ear to the drum at Moonduck TV on Twitter, at Beat Invitational, and at Northern Arena. All of those will be tweeting updates and all that good stuff. But I imagine it'll just be Monday, same place, same time, and we'll resume the schedule as normal. So lots to look forward to. If you enjoyed the cast, you can follow us both on Twitter. I'm at Sayori TV. He's at Mott Pax. You can find it in the title of this broadcast. Not to be confused with Mott, Naughty Motty, Main Stage Mott. This is Mott Pax. One's Canadian, one's from New York. Very different people.
Speaking of a shout out to Team Canada. Woo! We won. We beat the Ruskies.
Woo!
So get to go to the final of the World Cup of Hockey, which you probably don't even know is happening, eh?
No, I didn't.
Ah, good. Because Team USA ditched Phil Kessel.
Cool hockey.
They look like shit, so...
Go slap Canada. Shot.
Woo!
Give him the wraparound. Flying V.
Don Cherry.
Don Cherry. All right. We'll see you next time, folks. Thank you for joining us. We're out. This is it for Northern Arena by Bell today.